Sure.
So here's the second question. You say, in Creating Life in the Lab, that's your book, your book title, I argue that advances in synthetic biology indicate a creator must have played a role in the origin of life. What accomplishments in synthetic biology tell us about the origin of life? Or what do accomplishments in synthetic biology tell us about the origin of life? So how would you like to set that one up?
Yeah, well, one of the things that I think is really exciting in terms of the technology frontier is the very real prospects that scientists are going to be able to create artificial cells in the laboratory, and these are referred to as protocells, where you have these chemical supersystems that are beginning to assume the properties of a cell. And my thesis in the book, Creating Life in the Lab, is that the amount of ingenuity that's required in order to pull off even steps towards a true cellular entity is so enormous that it indicates that empirically intelligent agency is a critical ingredient in transforming chemicals into living systems. You know, because again, you've got these scientists that are developing these very impressive strategies to create artificial cells, and then on top of that, developing rather elaborate, ingenious protocols that are carried out in the lab by intelligent agents who are highly skilled. And so the argument would be that this is an empirical demonstration that intelligent agency is, again, a critical ingredient in bringing about life.
So let me this is what I understand you to say, is that in the lab, they are working on creating cells or subcells. And as they go through this process, it's excruciating detail on every part of the process. It has to be excruciatingly controlled. It's extremely precise, and you have to be extremely careful, otherwise the whole thing doesn't work out right. And you're saying because there is such extreme careful work going into every single step, and there's so many complex steps in all this, therefore it shows that life must have been created by God, because obviously nature can't do these kind of complex steps. Is that your argument, basically?
Yeah, it is. Although, in a sense, I'm not saying that nature can't do that, but rather I'm saying, again, I'm trying to frame it in a positive framework. In other words, we know from synthetic biology what it takes to produce a protocell. And again, intelligent agency is an indispensable component. And therefore, the argument would be, if that's the case, and we demonstrate this empirically, then it's reasonable to think that life's origin, too, required, again, the work of a mind. And so this is an attempt to frame another type of design argument that would be independent of the watchmaker approach.
Okay, well, let me tell you one of the things from my experience, and then you can tell me what you think of that. One time at work, this was many years ago, I was working on a circuit board, and there was a problem once in a while accessing memory. A certain memory location didn't work. And so I wrote a program to hammer this section of memory. And I got it to, because I'm hammering a certain section of it, it basically failed repeatedly. And then I was able to put a scope on it and actually look at the timing and all that. And we found out what the problem was. So just in the normal course of things, you know, it was very random. But when I created a special program for it, I can zoom in on the problem and see it. So I'm basically replicating in the lab something that didn't happen very often in normal use. So in the same way, why can't we say, as an evolutionist, I'm an evolutionist, that, you know, it took many years and many different weird circumstances for life to create, you know, like in scaffolding, you have to build one step at a time, and it happens at different places, different times, different events. And it took a long, long time. And so, of course, we can't reproduce that. But if we, you know, if we use our brain, we can shortcut it, like I did with my example. We can, you know, hurry it along by using our brain power. So basically, we're shrinking the time it takes to make something because we're removing all the extra variables that knock it out in a lot of cases. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. And again, to some degree, I would say you're somewhat making my argument for me, because again, you know, you're talking about short-circuiting variables, but then when you start thinking about what would this process require, you know, and here I'm talking about, you know, the origin of life, what would that process require on the early Earth, and then you're looking at such a complex chemical environment and physical environment that the variables are so enormous that there may not very well be any kind of pathway by which you could, even in that complexity, over a long enough period of time, produce things in a coherent manner that are going to lead to stepping stones towards the emergence of a protocell. Because again, it's that the process of short-circuiting the you know, in minimizing variables in the lab, that I think is where the intelligent agency is coming in to do it in an efficient and in direct way. Mm. And again, on the early Earth, the environment is so complex, it's difficult to envision, you know, how you would ever short-circuit those variables, particularly when, in many instances, the variables are actually counteracting one another.
Well, let me explain it a little different way. Let's say, for example, you have to do A and B to get C, and then you have to do C and D to get E, and then you have to do E and F to get G, and then G and H and get I. And some of these can go in parallel, like A and B can be make C over here, and then D and E can do F over here, and then the two can get together or something like that. And then once you get half of it built up, let's say the whole thing gets destroyed because of some other process comes in, or some kind of chemical or something toxic comes in, so the whole thing has to start over again. But sooner or later, this process gets through. So this is why maybe in nature it took a long time to get through, and all they're doing in the lab is they're all these killer things that come in from the side that knock it out, they're just eliminating those, and so they're just speeding it up.
Yeah. Well, you know, and I don't think I would make the statement that, you know, just because, let's say we're talking about A going to B, which is a critical step in generating, you know, the origin of life, but that A going to B is inhibited by other processes that are happening on the early Earth. There are other reactions that are converting A to C and A to D and things like that. You know, so you've got these competing reactions. You also got inhibitory, you know, processes. It's not to say mm-hmm. that you're not going to get some A eventually converting into B thermodynamically. That would have to happen to some degree. But the question is it productive enough, you know, even given a long period of time, is it productive enough to ultimately affect the origin of life? You know, and so that's, in a sense, the argument is that the intelligent agency is playing a critical role in short-circuiting the process to make, again, the origin of life actually happen.
Okay, but the thing is, we don't know really what the early Earth was like. I mean, that's what the science endeavor is all about, is trying to figure out what are some possibilities. You know, like Ken Ham always says, the young earthers, you know, were you there? No, we weren't there. I mean, sometimes they say this is probably what it was like. Sometimes they say this is what it was probably like.
I would agree that we don't know what the early Earth was like, but we have, you know, rock formations that go back to 3.8 billion years. We've actually got, you know, some things like zircon crystals that even date prior to that period of time. You know, we've got, you know, solar system formation models and things like that. So from that, we've got clues as to what the early Earth was like. Mm-hmm. And most certainly, it's going to be a chemically complex and physically complex environment. And we can speculate reasonably what kind of materials would have been present on the early Earth. You know, one of the things that origin of life researchers have been very successful at is actually identifying a number of conceivable processes that could have been in operation on the early Earth. Mm-hmm. And so when we, you know, or we could go to things like the Murchison meteorite and look at the kind of, you know, organic materials that are present in the Murchison, and then use that kind of as a proxy for what would likely be present on the early Earth. So, I mean, we don't know exactly, but we do know enough to say it was a chemically complex environment. And we would have an idea of the types of compounds that likely would be present, and we'd have an idea of the physical nature of the environment of the Earth, at least enough to say that complexity is going to be, you know, inhibitory and frustrating to any kind of coherent sequence of steps you need to bring about, again, the origin of life.
Well, you know, I think, though, something to always consider is to be a little bit humble, too, about what we really know in science. I mean, for example, if you go back maybe 50 years, certainly 100 years ago, I mean, before Einstein's time, in fact, I mean, before Einstein's time, you would say, well, obviously there's space and obviously there's time, and they're two different things. And then Einstein showed that space-time is a fabric, and you can warp them both to gravity, and that changes everything. So all the theories you have about space and time basically get thrown out the window when you understand that there's a space-time fabric that's warped by gravity. So I don't know. I think we could be just as naive about the early Earth. As far as, I mean, you know, there's so many different ice ages that at one point they didn't even know about ice ages, and then they said there's multiple ice ages, and so. And you know, another interesting thing too is if they actually did create life in the lab, they said, look, here's a bunch of chemicals, basic chemicals from the element table. Here's a process, and look, we have actually life formed here. This is a possible pathway. A creationist could still say, like, well, yeah, that's a possible pathway, but that doesn't mean that's the way it happened. That just proves you did something in the lab by controlling things.
Yeah, well, you know, and, you know, to your point, you know, it is possible that somebody could come along and have that, you know, that insight that is radical that suddenly changes the way that we look at things like the origin of life, and suddenly the problem is solved from a, you know, a natural process standpoint. But in a sense, we're appealing to the future, you know, to try to discern, you know, is the origin of life the work of a mind, or is it the work of evolutionary processes? And the best we can do is take the data that we have available to us at this point in time,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, try to draw conclusions that are reasonable, with the idea that our conclusions are ultimately going to be provisional. That's just the nature of science.
Okay.
But to me, you know, I'm deeply impressed with the work that I see. As a biochemist, I'm deeply impressed with the work that I see in synthetic biology. And, you know, the ingenuity is astounding. And so I applaud the people that are doing that work and have enormous respect for them. But I also think that, you know, the level of ingenuity that they're bringing to the table really does work against a naturalistic approach to the origin of life. I think it really is providing an empirical demonstration that time and time again, you know, the one thing that stands out in that work is the ingenuity of the researchers.
Well, yeah, and I guess we're at an impasse there, because to me it doesn't mean anything. They're just speeding things up by getting rid of a lot of other variables and defeaters along the way. So, okay, can we move on to the next one?
Oh yeah, sure.
Okay, this is.